There was a wonderful jazz club in Detroit that I used to go to. It's kind of a dump. There's a place. But the musicians who played there were just fantastic. And this is about, for the first time, seeing and hearing, not only seeing, but hearing Clifford Brown, a great trumpeter, who died in an auto accident not long after this moment. And it was, you know, because I never had a chance to hear him again live. And so it, the moment was just sort of carved into my consciousness, in my memory, and I've never forgotten. There's a beautiful melody. So I remember Clifford. It was written by an alto saxophone. You play the alto. Remember his name? No, it's okay. Yeah, you can hum it. Yeah, it's beautiful. It's all right. It's all right. No, don't be distracted. No, no. Yes, it was
Benny Gold.
What? Benny Gold. Yes. Benny Gold. Thank you. Yep. Anyway, he, of course, he wasn't playing, I remember, Clifford, because he was still alive, and the tune was written after he died. I don't think he was more than 25 or 60. You can find him. Max Brooks, they had a little quintet or four. I remember him. Wakening in a small room, the walls high and blue, one high window through which the morning enters. I turned to the table beside me, painted a thick white. There, instead of a clock, is a tumbler of water, clear and cold as wasn't there last night. Someone quietly entered, and now I see the white door slightly ajar, and around three sides the light on fire. I remember once, 27 years ago, walking the darkened streets of my hometown. When up ahead on Joy Road at the Bluebird of Happiness, I heard over the rumble of traffic and the rumbling of my own head, for the first time, the high, clear trumpet of Clifford Brown, calling us all to the dance he shared with us such a short time. My heart quickened, and in my long coat, breathless and stumbling, I ran through the swirling snow to the familiar sequin door, knowing it would open on something new. You know, I've written a lot of depressing poems.
Some people would say that you've really achieved the pinnacle of accomplishment for a poet, now that you're the Poet Laureate of the U.S., but I'm wondering, do you have other things you'd like to accomplish with your poetry that you haven't yet?
Well, I don't think becoming the Poet Laureate is a pinnacle. I think it's just a thing. You know, if the Library of Congress says, oh boy, he's the poet. You know, some of those poets can't write with a damn who've been the Poet Laureate. You know, it's like the Pulitzer Prize. There's poets there I could never read. I mean, it's somebody made a decision at the Library of Congress. I don't know how the decision was made. I'm glad it was made in my favor. I'm glad that I got the Pulitzer Prize. It sold a lot of books. It made my editors very happy. It made my mom happy. I wish she'd lived long enough to see me the Poet Laureate. She would have bragged to all her friends. What did your son do? But it is not the pinnacle. There is no pinnacle, I suppose. But what matters most to me is to be honored by my fellow poets, especially the ones whose work I love. Remember that when I was quite young, I went to New York to hear Dylan Tom, the Welsh poet, read. I'd heard him once, and one of the things he said was, he struck me. He said, I send my poems out in envelopes, and the envelopes come back And sometimes there are checks. And then I live for a while. And sometimes the poems alone come back. With their tails between their legs. And I thought, here's my son. He's thinking of poems of new workers. And here's Dylan Thomas thinking of them as creatures. And so that's one thing that motivated me to take all these poems that were out of print and get them working again and get them wagging their tails.
Yes, ma'am.
What makes a good poem?
Usually a good poet. Yeah, you can't answer the question. Yes, ma'am.
Suspending your rational mind when you're writing.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
You talked about suspending your rational mind when you're writing. Do you sometimes start to write one thing, but you sort of suspend it and you end up off somewhere else?
More often than not, yes, do I sometimes start from one kind of a poem, wind up writing a different one. Yeah, that's more often than not. You know, I start with words. What else am I going to start with? numbers? No. So I start with words and often with a kind of melody. It's the best term I guess I can think of. Kind of melody that the words are making. And they often they lead to nothing. But when it's going well, they lead to something. And it's quite thrilling. It's what you live for. It's what's exciting. Yeah, I mean, I think if you always knew where it was going, you wouldn't even bother following it. You know, because you say to yourself, I already did that. You know, that's the mountain I have to keep getting over. Yeah, I've written a lot of poems, so I don't want to write bad imitations of the poems I already wrote, but that's tempting. You know, I mean, I look at the New Yorker, why don't I have a poem there this week? Oh, let me go back and look at one of those poems that appeared and just modified a little bit, you know. So that's what I have to try to avoid, imitating myself. And I do try. I'm not always successful. Let's have one more question. Yes?
Do you have a poem that wrote itself?
A poem that wrote itself? That's an interesting phrase. I have a poem that my dear friend, I had a friend, he's dead now, he was once my student, he was the best student I ever had, his name was Larry Levin, the fantastic poet. I'm talking about him today, Winter Stars. It's an amazing book, University of Pennsylvania. Just a fantastic poem. And I sent him a poem once. I think the poem's called Salt and Oil. It's about two guys that I grew up with. I don't tell that I grew up with them, but there's two guys, and I'm seeing them in the city, and they're doing all kinds of things. And they're very different. They react to the same moment. One has oil, and one has salt. And I sent it to Larry, and he wrote me back. He said, I love it when you send me those poems, the poems that wrote them. And I look at it, and I said, Larry's right. In the sense that I wasn't really commanding this poem, I was chasing, you know? And it came fairly quickly, and it's like a gift. It was like the gift that you got from dedicating your life to this ridiculous thing. So then you got a gift, and it was a good poem, and you chased it. Yeah, it's happened. I wish it would have happened tomorrow. I was winging toward LaGuardia.
I remember once taking up so much time looking for a poem, then thinking seriously about it. Why can't I find it? And then realizing the reason that I couldn't find it is I didn't write it. It was a poem that I kind of wrote, but never got it to where it was any good. You know, I kept striving to get this poem, and I couldn't finish it. But it was always in my head that you have to do, I never had finished it. I can't read tonight because it doesn't exist. presented for the two wonderful musicians, the Augustus. And it is about a great musician that I heard near the end of her life in Detroit, Billie Holiday. And there was something, I don't know, I tried to get it home, something very special about the stage art. Some sense that there wouldn't be many more evenings. Dawn coming in over the fields of darkness. The darkness takes me by surprise, and I look up from my solitary road, pleased not to be alone. The birds now choiring from the orange grove, huddling to the low hills. But sorry that this night is ending, a night in which you spoke of how little love we seem to have known, and all of it going from one of us to the other. You could tell the words took me by surprise, as they often will, and you grew shy and held me away for a while, your eyes enormous in the dark, almost as large as your hunger to see and be seen over and over. 30 years ago, I heard a woman sing of the motherless child sometimes she felt like. In a white dress, this black woman with a gardenia in her hair leaned on the piano and stared out into the breathing darkness of unknown men and women needing her song. There were those among us who cried, those who rejoiced that she was back before us for a time not to be much longer. For the voice was going and the habit slowly becoming all there was. And I believe that night she cared for the purity of the song, and not much else. Oh, she still saw the slow gathering of that red dust that hovered over the city. And no doubt dawns like this one caught her on the road from job to job. But the words she'd lived by were drained of mystery, as this sky is now. And there was no more easy living. And she was Miss Brown to no one. And no one was her lover. The only songs that mattered were words, like those rising in confusion from the trees, or wind songs that waken the grass that slept attention, that waken me to how far we've come. There are those moments, you know, when you go to hear music, and in a way you know that this moment you will never forget. And for me, it's almost always jazz, although one time the great challenge, one of the unaccompanied composition. I could die. I'm the only composer in this, and the cellist was in there. And it was, you know, I just thought, I don't care how long.